Break. Albert Einstein wisely said that the measure of intelligence is the ability to change. Today's educators focused on preparing the students for a world class of technology are the fastest learners by adapting the dynamically changing their teaching methods. With the exploding growth of advancements in every domain, the pursuit of knowledge, wisdom, truth, and philosophy is never ending in life. With immense pleasure, I welcome you all for the technical session 3 on Teaching for Global Competence with EdTech, Sustaining Teaching Excellence in Virtual Classrooms. We have with us a dynamic leader, Sri Gurumurthy Kasinathan, founder, member, and director, IT for Change, Bangalore, to make us excel in teaching and take forward our classrooms to a succeeding level. I take immense pleasure to introduce sir to you all. He is having a wide expertise and different experience in heterogeneous areas. 11 years in IT business sector in a global IT product and service company, Oracle Financial Services. 6 years in Government of Karnataka Education Department in the Policy Planning Unit 1, 7 years as a visiting faculty at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, a deemed university, 6 years in Education Technology and Education Leadership and Management and Education Policy in Azim Premji Foundation and NGO, and 4 years also as a management consultant in KPMG. With more than 3 decades of experience across development, government, academic, and corporate sector, he has contributed more into academics by framing the curriculum and syllabi for NCERT ICT textbook for class 10 in August 2019 and for class 9 in July 2018. He has also developed toolkit for teachers to create OER using FOSS Commonwealth of Learning 2017, ICT Student Textbook and Teacher Handbook, Telangana Department of School of Education in 2016, ICT Meditation in Teaching and Learning, Karnataka DELD Curriculum Revision, DSERT 2016, ICT and Education, TISS MA Education 2015. During his work tenure, he has designed and transacted online courses for Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangantar, Karnataka Residential Education Institution Society, KREIS Montfort Institutions, Global MOOC, MOOC for Mathematics Teachers in collaboration with Commonwealth of Learning Canada, Vijaya Teachers College, Sarvajana College of Education, NMKRV College for Girls, Regional Institute of English, South India, RIESI. He has also led as a OER program of ITFC with Department of Education, Karnataka and Telangana to use digital tools and methods to create open educational resources, a global cutting-edge model for curricular resource design and development. And also open street GIS mapping in Mysore with the support from UNESCO. Pramathma program of the Policy Planning Unit, which included an organization re-engineering and also a study on education system through the management consulting firm PricewaterhouseCoopers. Sir has also designed and implemented variety of education sector studies and capacity building programs like ICT capacity building programs for officials of Karnataka public education system from 2005 to 2008. Sri Gurumurthy Kasinathan also contributed to the research community by publishing 25 book chapters, articles, and media articles, and 3 policy briefs and position papers too. Sir, you are the right person for this session, and I now request you to address the gathering. Hearty welcome, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Aruna. I hope I did not bore the participants who are all illustrious heads of institutions and teachers in different schools to hear such a long introduction. Sorry for inflicting it on you. Basically, I would like to call myself a teacher educator, exploring how digital technologies can be used for making schools more effective in what they try to do. Now, I also noticed that many of the people in the audience have already heard me before. Dr. Neela has already heard me before, and I think many of the teachers in the Montfort group of institutions might have already heard me before. So for some of you, it may be a repetition. I'm really sorry about that. But I think that majority of the participants may not have heard me. So I will stick to the few things that I usually say about free and open source software, about open education resources. That's what I will say in this session also. So if it's boring, you've heard it before, then I will not mind if you, put me on mute and proceed with what you're otherwise doing. But if you've not heard me before, I look forward to engaging with all of you over the next 1 hour or so. So I've got a question for all of you in the chat window. Sorry, I just put it again. Yeah, so when we say EdTech, so I've got a topic to look at EdTech and how EdTech can support schools. So all of you would have some idea about EdTech or education technology. We call it ICT. We call it information and communication technologies. Is the audio better now? Am I more audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
yes,
thank
yes.
you. Thanks for that feedback. So the question for all of you is, when we say EdTech, you can answer in the chat window, you can unmute and speak, but I guess there are many participants, so typing in the chat window is also fine. I'll be looking at the chat window. When we say EdTech, or we say education technology, or ICT, information and communication technology, or digital technology, all these things really, we mean the same thing. What are the thoughts that come to your mind? What challenges are there? What possibilities do you see? What harm do you see? What benefits do you see? What practical issues and challenges and problems you see? If you can just spend the next 1 minute typing on the chat window, it's a good basis for me to actually talk on some of them, because at the end of the day, if I try to address some of the issues that you're having, then it might be more make more sense for you. I'm going to increase the audio still more.
Yes, sir.
Some
yeah,
of you
can
are
you
not
just
able
check,
to hear.
Sir?
Yeah. Is it better now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there's no sound disturbance, I hope. I hope the audio is okay.
Fine, sir. Fine now, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so I want all of you to quickly type in the chat window. What's the top thought in your mind when we say education technology or ICT or digital technology? What benefits you see, what problems you see, what challenges you see? So there are many possibilities to teach better. So I will talk about that primarily today, the possibilities to use EdTech to teach better. So I'm not going to talk so much about computer programming. The previous speaker looked at computer programming or website design, those kind of technical vocations from technology. I'm not going to talk so much about those aspects. I will talk about regular subject teachers, regular teachers using technology. So one of the challenges, of course, is the rural-urban student challenge, accessibility challenge. I will be addressing that in my talk. I will certainly look at the problems of connectivity that rural areas have. I think the urban-rural problem is primarily one of connectivity. Traditional parents to convince modern use of technology in teaching learning. I'm not so sure about that. I think parents might be quite happy to if the school uses digital technologies. They may not know what the school is trying to do. But if you put out a board saying computers are taught here, it's certainly going to be favorably received by the parents, whether or not it is useful or not useful. To get updated, teacher-student relationship is a minimum. So there is apprehension that it might affect the student-teacher relationship. I would like to understand, why should technology affect student-teacher relationship? I'm not very sure. Unless you mean that students are going to watch videos and not pay attention to the teacher. I don't know if that is what was meant there. Catherine again is saying, there is a lot of concern about rural areas because I think many of you are working in rural areas. So naturally, you do not have the in many rural areas, the benefit of connectivity, the benefit of support, the benefit of maintenance of technical equipment may not be there. And I think that will be a problem. Net connection. Okay. Fine. So Okay, thank you so much for your points, and I think I'm picking up two or three things which I will certainly talk about in my sessions. So digital technology, what I am going to talk about today is mainly what regular teachers in your school can use. So I'm not going to talk about something, I think the previous speaker spoke about getting engineers, the Haryana model, where engineers who have finished their engineering subject, they come and teach technology learning to the students in the school. So they may be teaching computer programming, or they may be teaching website design, or they may teach writing code algorithms itself. So those are the kind of things that engineers can do. Simi is saying boring. So that's very provocative and nice. So I'm going to show something which I believe is not going to be boring. So let me share my screen now, and I'm going to show you a couple of applications. We will start by looking at some of the applications that we have been using in schools for a long time. So I hope the screen, are you all able to see a circle? Is a circle visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Dr. Aruna, yes, thank you, Dr. Aruna, for confirming. So Simi said it's boring, so I'm going to request Simi to tell me what is it that you see on the screen. Can Simi madam, Simi Bhatti madam, unmute and say what's on the screen? Online teaching, yeah, no problem, doesn't matter. She's clarifying that the boring part kind of comes to online teaching. I completely agree. I think online teaching is a torture for the students. It's a bigger torture for the teachers, but we don't have a choice about it now. That's the only problem. Yes, Simi madam, can you tell me what is there on the screen that you can see? You can type in the chat window. You can also unmute and speak. Is Simi madam able to speak? Dr. Aruna, can you just help her? Host is not allowing. You can unmute her so that she can speak.
Yeah, ma'am, raise your hand, whoever it is.
Hello, sir. Good evening. Good evening.
Yes. Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening, so, evening sir. I'm sorry, sir. I think you misunderstood. I was telling about the online teaching, not your teaching.
No. Don't at all feel, no need to apologize. I completely.
I just wanted to say ki when you are face to face, though, I find it very interesting, and my students take a lot of interest when I teach them.
Yes.
Keep their videos open. I teach social studies, sir. I'm in Kendra Vidyalaya.
Very good, very good. And which grades do you teach?
I'm TGT, sir.
TGT. So you teach high school?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. What is your favorite subject?
Mine is, of course, social studies, because I teach geography is the best part geography, I can teach.
Okay, so I'm going to show you something that will help you to teach geography. You may already have been familiar with a software called Marble. Have you heard of a software called Marble?
Yes, sir, I have.
Have you used
Marble?
But I'm
not able to use it.
Use it. Okay. So I will show.
I don't know.
Today I will show you how to use Marble to make geography even more interesting. I believe all subjects are interesting. I certainly think geography is interesting. And I think we can use digital atlases to make geography more interesting. So I'll show that in my talk today. But on the screen, you can see a circle. Can you say anything about the circle, madam? Can you say anything about the circle that you see on the screen?
One more person has raised a hand. Molly, okay. PJ, I think.
Okay, fine. We can request. So I will come back to you with geography a little later, but we can ask whoever has raised their hand about what they see on the screen here. Yeah, somebody's already actually answered. There's a circle with a radius of 0.5. So I'm going to show something, and then you can, whoever is wanting to answer it can answer. So I'm going to do something. Yeah. Can anybody say what's being demonstrated here? I would say any teacher can say this, because it's high school maths, and even if you're a social science or a language teacher, obviously you have been through this high school maths yourself. But can anybody say what is being demonstrated here? Yeah. Can anybody unmute and talk? That will be better. Dr. Aruna, is it possible for anybody who wants to talk to actually unmute and speak about it rather
than only. If they raise hand, we can easily identify. Otherwise, they can put it in chat window so that we know they are.
I want Nisha Singh has suggested, or a couple of people have suggested. So is it possible for them to unmute, or you have to
unmuting Nisha ma'am?
Yeah. Nisha ma'am, can you tell me what is it that you're seeing in the screen here, and what is it? What concept can it be used to illustrate? This is obviously geometry. We are also
Thank you so much, and very good evening. Actually, what I feel is total outside whatever is it is in centimeter or what, that exact value of it you are showing on the scale or on the axis that is being given by you. So that what exactly is the circumference?
Yeah. What is the concept? Is there a concept being taught here? What concept is, you're right, it's a circumference. The red line which we see is a circumference. What concept is being taught here? Can you say what concept could be taught here with this particular diagram? And I request
Go ahead. I can just see that the circle is here, and then it's difficult to measure the the round part of it, but as we make it a straight line, we are able to measure it. So that's what you are showing it here to all.
Yeah, thank you so much. Can I request Sushma Gautam to explain? Thank you so much. Your explanation was not wrong, but I'm looking for something a little bit more. I request all of you to pay attention to this demonstration, even if you are a math teacher or a social science teacher or language teacher, does not matter, because this is something which is a high school mathematics. All of us have been through it. And let me tell you my own background. I'm not a BSc, I'm not a BA, I'm a BCom. I've done my commerce and I did my CA after that. I started learning mathematics more after I got introduced to these tools. So I fell in love with, I was always fond of mathematics, but after I discovered this particular software, my love for mathematics increased. So if some of you don't like mathematics, you can actually fall in love with mathematics by looking at the software. My request to all of you, therefore, please be in the demonstration, whether or not you teach mathematics. Thank you so much. Yes, who did I request to explain? Sushma madam, right? Can Sushma madam unmute and say,
yes, sir, by seeing the graph, I am understanding that it is very difficult to express the distance in circular path. But when we put this circular distance in straight, anyone can measure. It will be easy to measure the circumference of the circumference in form of straight line.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. I thank you again. So let me, I'm going to elaborate a little bit more. So I'll come back from the problem of mathematics teaching in school. And this may be true for some of the schools that who are participating in this particular meet. It may not be true for everybody. So kindly do not mistake me. I'm not trying to criticize teachers or criticize a subject. I'm just trying to bring out some of the challenges that are there and how maybe using technology may be useful. So for example, a big problem in mathematics.
They unmuted me.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Sister Jacinta, you have any queries?
Sister Jacinta, you want to explain? Go ahead. Then I can speak after you. No problem. Or no problem. Let me continue. So one of the challenges in mathematics teaching, and we all know that of all the subjects, if students were asked which subject you like the least or which subject you are afraid of, there is a good chance mathematics will be the top of the list. I hope you will agree with me, all of you, even if you teach maths or otherwise. One of the challenges that we have is that students develop a dislike for mathematics. They develop a hatred for mathematics. And once they develop a dislike or hatred for mathematics, it affects their learning of maths. One of the main reasons for this dislike is when we teach mathematics, they pick up the algorithm. They pick up the mechanics of the particular topic being taught, but they don't understand the concept that is being taught. And if they are understanding the concept, then certainly they will remember the idea much more in life. So the concept here that is being taught of is really a concept called pi. Now, we all have heard the word pi. And many times in my workshops, when I ask teachers, what is pi? Can people type in the chat window? If I ask the question, what is pi? What kind of answers will students most likely give? When you ask the question, what is pi? Already Sister Jacqueline has written in the last chat, value of pi is 3.14. But if the question is asked, what is pi? And pi is pi, of course, not pie. So I'm going to ask the question, what is pi? If I were to ask this question, what is the answer that students are likely to give? So some of the answers that are coming are 22 by 7. And some of the answers is 3 by 1.4 and 22 by 7, 3.14, constant. But actually, these are wrong answers. And this is the problem with mathematics teaching and learning, because even in school, if I were to be asked, what is pi? I will say pi is 22 by 7. But pi is not 22 by 7. One of the participants has given the correct, yeah, Dr. Alka Agarwal has given the answer, which is the correct answer. The correct answer is pi is a ratio of circumference to diameter. The value of pi approximates to 3.14 or 22 by 7. We all know that actually the value of pi is not exactly 3.14. It's an irrational number. It is a it's recurring, non-terminating and non-repeating. So it is a recurring decimal, non-repeating and non-terminating. So the ratio of circumference to the diameter is actually pi. But students do not understand that concept. They only know that pi is 22 by 7 or 3.14. Therefore, in the examination, a sum will be given where the value of some, you know, the diameter may be 49 or 154 or 7. And they know they have to multiply or divide by 22 by 7. So when the students understand that there is a beauty that always when you draw any circle, whenever you draw a circle, you measure the diameter and you measure the circumference. The ratio of the circumference to the diameter is always going to be 3.14. That is the concept that is being explained by this simple process of, if the diameter of the circle is 1, so the radius is 0.5 as you correctly identified. Since the radius is 0.5, it means the diameter is 1. If the diameter of the circle is 1, then the circumference is 3.14, which is pi. So this particular file in GeoGebra, this is a software called GeoGebra. It is one of my favorite software applications that I have learned. And as I said earlier, this GeoGebra software made me fall in love with mathematics all over again. And I find whenever mathematics teachers start using GeoGebra, their affinity for using technology for teaching improves a lot. They just fall in love with the tool because it's a very powerful tool for teaching different topics in geometry and algebra. Now, this is a software. It is not a video. It is not a ready-made content that is given to you. This GeoGebra is the name of a software. Now, very important thing, this GeoGebra is a desktop software. What does it mean? Desktop software means you can put in the computer, no need for web connection. Already in the this session, many people mentioned that rural areas connectivity is a very big problem. Even if connectivity is there, it is a running expense. But this particular software called GeoGebra is directly installable on your computer. No need to connect to the web for it. No need to pay any license fees. I will explain to you later on why license fees is not required to be paid. So this is a software that helps us to teach algebra and geometry, right? So any questions on that? I'm going to show you one more file on this, but any questions anybody has got? So this is a topic. This is nothing but, as Sister Jacqueline says, ratio of circle, the circumference ratio to diameter is explained by this. Of course, we can do physically also. You can take a thread and then you can roll the thread. Very difficult. In GeoGebra, we can, in animation, we can show that it is the principle of pi is computed in this particular manner. Then students will understand that, hey, it's a magic. Mathematics is magic. That whatever circle, whatever size of the circle I draw, you can ask students to draw 10 circles, 15 circles of different dimensions, having different radius and diameter. But the ratio of circumference to diameter will always come to roughly around 3.14. Okay. Any questions? I'm going to share the screen and show another file of GeoGebra. Then I'll go to other subjects also. Yeah, any questions, feel free to ask in the meantime. Okay, can everybody see a triangle on the screen? The volume is still low. I'll increase the volume a little bit more. Is the volume okay now? Anand sir, is my volume okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Aarti madam, my colleague Anand Desai sir just shared this name of the software. What is the practical application of this concept to life? Johnny sir is asking very good question. So for example, you are having a circular stadium. Okay, you are imagine that you are having a circular stadium. You have a hockey, you have a cricket stadium in your town, and in the cricket stadium, you want to construct a compound wall. Now, one way of measuring the compound wall is actually to take a rope and measure the compound wall itself. But instead of that, if you could measure the radius of the particular stadium, cricket stadium, you could calculate the circumference by multiplying the radius by 2 pi, correct? So 2 pi r is circumference. You multiply 2 into 22 by 7 into the radius of the stadium, you can get the circumference of the stadium on which you want to construct a compound wall. Okay, so that is one way of using practical application of the idea of pi to real life. GeoGebra is to teach mathematics. Mathematics is applied to real life. GeoGebra is not directly applied to real life. GeoGebra can be used for learning mathematics conceptually. And this mathematics, what we are learning conceptually well, we can apply to real life. I hope Johnny sir is clear on that point. Okay. Can somebody tell me what's on the screen? What can you see on the screen now? Can anybody say what do they see on the screen? Is it visible, Dr. Aruna? I can't hear. You are muted.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Very much visible.
Yeah, okay. Can anybody share what is on the screen? Have I already successfully put everybody to sleep? Yeah, triangle. Many people are replying that it's a triangle. So now this is called a regular polygon. Regular polygon is nothing but a polygon where all the sides are of the same length. I'm going to show some concept which is very interesting because it is talking about something beyond what we are able to see here. So now if you can see on the screen, I got something called A. A is nothing but the number of sides of this regular polygon. So when I say A equal to 3, I've got a square, I've got a triangle. When A become to 4, it's a quadrilateral. It's a, all sides are equal in length, so it's a square. When I do 5, it's a pentagon. When it becomes 6, it's a hexagon, then septagon, octagon. Can anybody say what is happening? Can anybody, by visually seeing this, see what is happening? Can anybody type in the chat window? What is actually happening here to the polygon? Can anybody guess? Can anybody explain what's happening on the chat window? As the sides of the polygon increases, what do you see happening? Yeah, by increasing the number of sides of this regular polygon, it is mutating. Yes, so Shamli Williams has said, can Shamli Williams unmute and say, what is this phenomenon? How do you explain this phenomenon? Can you say what is happening here, Shamli Williams? Or anybody can unmute and speak. What exactly is, what can we say is explained through this particular file? I'm sorry, I'm asking a lot of questions. Can anybody say what's happening, Dr. Alka Agarwal? Nature of polygon slowly changing to circular. Dr. Alka Agarwal, can you explain this?
Okay, very good afternoon, sir. Slowly and slowly, the nature of the polygon is changing and it's changing to circular dimensions.
Will it become a circle at any time?
If the number of sides becomes infinity.
Yeah, so can you tell me what is a concept that's being explained by this particular becoming infinity that you say? I think that's a correct expression. What is the concept that can be highlighted in this? It's, I think, a topic that comes in PU, maybe not in high school. What concept can be explained by this particular phenomenon that you're seeing in front of you?
That in a circle, the number of sides are infinite, and then any polygon can be changed into a circle.
Okay. Anybody else has a, I'm not saying you're wrong, but I had certain specific. What is the concept that one can talk about when we say this? What is the concept that when we say as the number of sides becomes tends towards infinity, the polygon, regular polygon becomes a circle? What topic would be, what is the topic that would discuss this particular idea? Can anybody say? Two participants have raised their hands. Dr. Aruna, can you unmute them and ask?
I have unmuted, sir.
Yeah. What is the concept that is being understood here? Sorry, too much of maths. I'll stop.
With distance, this. distance between these points, they decrease. As we increase the number of line segments, so distance between the two end points, they will coincide. So we can have a set of points, a number of set, infinite number of points on the circumference, and the distance between these two points, it is almost zero.
Actually, that is not the case. The distance between two points, if you see, remains constant. So if you are seeing the polygons that are being constructed, the distance between any two points is constant. It is not actually reducing. The number of sides is increasing, but the distance between, let's say, point A and point B. You see point A and point B?
The distance between these remains two points constant. Exactly.
It remains constant, so it doesn't reduce. So that is not the explanation that will address this particular phenomena that I'm showing. One of the participants already explained in the chat window. I think Danya madam has already explained in the chat window that it is nothing but your calculus. So limit as n tends to infinity. You know, for we learn in not in high school. I think calculus comes in maybe your PU or your BSc. I'm not very sure, but when students, we explain to them saying n tending towards infinity or n tending towards zero, students find it very difficult to understand. You agree with me? The whole calculus starts with limits. When we go, before we go to differentiation, before we go to integration, we first talk about limits. And in limits, we say limit as n tend towards infinity. But it's very difficult for the student to visualize what is the meaning of tending towards infinity. Either you get it, but sometimes you don't get it, and sometimes you may not get it at the class. Now, this is a very simple way of using GeoGebra to demonstrate what is the visual meaning of n tending towards infinity. So, in both these cases, I use the visualization power of GeoGebra. One is to explain the relationship between circumference and radius of a circle, and second is to highlight a concept of limits of tending towards infinity. So as the number of sides of a regular polygon tends towards infinity, it can never become infinity because by definition, infinity is something which we cannot reach. So the number of sides will never become infinity. But as it proceeds towards infinity, it approximates a circle. When the number of sides is infinity, it will be a circle, but that is a non-existent object, right? So that is what I wanted to explain.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I just wanted to say whatever you have, I think already explained. So a circle is a limiting case of a polynomial as sides increase to infinity.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine, sir. So that's another way of explaining the same concept. I was saying that we can also say it in this way that normally when we talk about limits, when we explain limits, we always say limits as n tends to infinity in the bottom we write, right? So that can be explained visually using this particular lesson. Now, each of this is a lesson. So if you see what I'm doing, you can see the file on top, right? So you all can see what I'm doing. There is a file save as option. So this is nothing but a GeoGebra file. So any number of teachers can create GeoGebra files using the GeoGebra software. And you can use it to teach the students mathematics concepts right from number line. In fact, even addition of numbers, subtraction of numbers, multiplication of numbers can be taught using the number line. Decimals, fractions, addition of fractions are all available as GeoGebra files. So in the chat window, I'm going to type the name of the website. There is one website where you can get all these GeoGebra files. Okay, that website is called GeoGebra.org. One second, let me just... I'm not able to type in the chat window. Anand sir, can you just type it in the chat window? Because it's only giving, yeah. GeoGebra.org. Okay, just type that, GeoGebra.org, Anand sir. So that is the file, that's a website where you can get all kinds of GeoGebra files. And you can use it for teaching different kinds of subjects, okay? There's a lot of disturbance. Somebody
has to go.
Yeah, shall we go ahead? Now I'll go to my presentation itself.
I think he has a network issue.
Hello. Gurumurthy sir, we can't hear you.
Okay, friends, by the time sir sorts out is the technical issues, just wanted to remind you once again about tomorrow's session. Tomorrow, not at 4:30, 3 o'clock. Tomorrow, we would start the session and kindly note the timing, not 4:30, 3 o'clock. 3 to 4, we have the panel discussion. This is on moving from, striving from to, surviving. Because all of our institutions, we were one of the best institutions in our areas. But during this pandemic, I think many of us are having, a lot of other challenges. So how do we, survive, right? Whenever situation changes, our focus also should change. So what is going to be our focus? And we are interested in identifying some of the best practices of our institutions. In case some of you would like to share the best practices in your institution, kindly text to us or put it there, edumeet@christujayanti.com. You can tell us, we can give you a short time and you can present that. Then we will continue the other sessions. Okay. Thank you, Gurumurthy sir, joining back.
Welcome, sir.
Hello. Can I share my screen?
Sorry, yes.
My system hanged, so I had to reboot my system. So I'll just share my screen again. Yeah, can you all see a slide now?
Yes, sir.
We have gone from GeoGebra to presentation slides, so something more comfortable for everybody. So today I'm going to talk to you all about what we call as free and open source software, which many of you may be aware and many of you may not have heard of. Free and open source software can be used in all the schools. And as the name suggests, free and open source, there is no license fee to be paid for it. It doesn't require internet also. So you can install this in all the computers in your lab if you have a computer lab. So some of the schools may be having computer labs. Some of the schools may not have computer labs. But whichever school is having a computer lab, you can install this software and some few other software applications that I'm going to talk about, so that every teacher can use these particular software applications, okay? So I'm going to start by talking very briefly about the nature of knowledge. And I think this is something I don't need to really persuade you to believe, because all of you know that knowledge belongs to all of us. We are teachers, and therefore our job is to share knowledge with everybody. And we will strongly believe that knowledge belongs to all of us. So I want to point out one very sad thing that's happening in today's time. Today I took my daughters for vaccination, and we went to a private hospital and I had to pay 900 rupees per vaccine for both of them to get vaccinated. So this is a very unusual phenomenon, because in the history of India, vaccines have always been given free of cost to everybody. And that is because one of the reasons for that is there is no patent on vaccine so far. Today we are seeing in the case of COVID that the vaccine of COVID is intellectual property for Covaxin, for Covishield, for Moderna, for Pfizer. All these vaccines are patented by companies. Because it is patented by the companies, it cannot be freely produced by everybody. Whereas the earlier vaccines, so if you see the screen here, not only I'm talking about Newton's laws of motion, but even the polio vaccine, the person who invented the polio vaccine said, I am not going to patent it, because the polio vaccine should be available to everybody to freely produce and freely share. Of course, all of us are not going to produce polio vaccines, but anybody who's got a manufacturing facility can manufacture polio vaccine without taking permission from anybody. That is not the case with Covaxin. That's not the case with Covishield, which is something which must disturb all of us, that knowledge is being not allowed to be shared. And the software that all of us use is like that. We use Microsoft Windows, we use Apple computers, we use Mac OS and Apple computers. All those software cannot be shared. So if you've got Microsoft Windows on your computers in your lab, if you've got 10 computers, you buy a new computer, you have to pay money for Microsoft Windows 11th time, because Microsoft will not allow you to own the software. I hope you all understand that when you are paying the money for Microsoft Windows, it is not as if you are owning the software, because the software still belongs to Microsoft only, but you, Microsoft is simply giving you the permission to use the software. Okay. So I'm going to look at my chat window also, if there is anything on the chat window. If there are any questions, you can keep typing in the chat. I'm going to see the chat as well. Yeah. So did you all know that the Microsoft Windows or the Apple system that you bought, that software, even if you paid money for it, you are not the owner of that software? Is that understood by everybody? You are only given the license to use the software. So if you went and bought a computer, you can give the computer to anybody. But if you bought the software doesn't belong to you. It belongs to Microsoft only. And that problem is because it is called proprietary software. Okay. Now, important thing is, because knowledge is free, there are people who felt that even software should be freely available to everybody. And that's how the world of free and open source software came into being, where the software is made such a way that people can freely share it. So that is called free and open source software. It is called FOSS in short. And one of the things that my organization, IT for Change, is advocating across schools, across colleges in the country is, in the school system, because schools are places for free sharing of knowledge, school is a place where knowledge is freely shared, we should also use software that we can freely share. Therefore, we should use only FOSS in our schools and colleges. Okay, that is the basic argument that I'm making in this particular slide. Any questions anybody has got? You want to type in the chat window? Any questions, any comments on what this particular slide says? Anybody wants to say anything? Anybody has a question? Anybody has a doubt? Otherwise, I will go ahead. If there are any questions, feel free to ask. Yeah, okay, I'll continue. So let me advance my slide. Yeah. So the point I'm making is, just as knowledge is something that we can freely share, we should think of technology also as something that we can freely share. So you can see the two rabbits on the screen, they're sharing a piece of cheese. So the essence of schooling, the essence of education is sharing. And that's why we have public education. So all of you are running schools. Some of you may be running private schools, but I'm sure that for many of you, the fees that you charge is not recovering the entire cost of running the institution. You are philanthropies, and there is money being put into the institution so that students can get good education without having to pay for it. In a poor country like India, maybe 5% or 10% of the students may be able to afford the real cost of education. And that is, we see the very expensive schools that are there. But for 70-80% of the students, we should give them good education even if they cannot afford it. And that's where we have the concept of a public education system. It may be a government school, it may be a government-aided school, it may be an unaided school, but supported by public philanthropy. For example, the Christu Jayanti set of institutions or the Montfort set of institutions, the fees that are charged are reasonable so that it does not prevent the interested children from coming to school simply because they are not able to afford the fees. In the same way, we should not make a situation where technology or software is so expensive that we cannot afford it. Some of us use Apple phones, some of us use Apple computers. We know these are very expensive. These are not possible for everybody in the country to use. All students, all teachers cannot use these particular devices. That's why it's important that in school system, we promote the use of free and open source software. Now, some of us who have not used free and open source software may think it's something very rare. Nobody uses it. Nobody is aware of it. That is actually not the case anymore. Kerala started using free and open source software in the year 2002, 19 years before today. Kerala was the pioneer in India that started using free and open source software from the year 2002 itself. Then Government of India, that is NCRT, we are all familiar with NCRT. NCRT came out with an ICT policy in education in 2012. And the NCRT ICT policy says we should use free and open source software in schools. So if you are using other software in schools, you are actually not working as per the policy of the Government of India. Of course, the Government of India is not enforcing this policy. It is not writing letters to principals saying, kindly use only free and open source software. It is not doing that. But the policy that the government came out in 2012 says that free and open source software should be used in schools. Okay. Now, what are these free and open source software? What does it mean? What are the principles of free and open source software? Who founded the free and open source software movement? These are questions that we are likely to have. So the person who started the free software movement is a professor. He's also a teacher only. He's an American. He taught at the MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And in 1981, he felt that software should not be made as prevented from being shared, and he created the free software movement. Free software means there are four principles. What are the four principles? First principle is you should be able to study the software. It should be available to you. By study means you can open the source code and you can study it. Now you may say, I'm a teacher, I'm a head teacher, I'm a principal. Why should I study the software? It's not my job. But some student in your school, some student in your college, some student in the engineering college may want to open the software, study it so that they can make it better. So the first freedom is freedom to study. The second freedom, which is very important for all of us, is we can make copies of it. So if you have one Microsoft Office DVD, you can't make a copy of it legally. Illegally, you may still be doing it. You may be making what is called as pirated copies. You all heard of the word pirated software, correct? So we pirate the software because we don't want to make the payment to the company for using the software on multiple systems, but it is illegal. You can go to jail. Police can come and arrest you. If you are working in a school, you're all working in schools. If in your school, you're using pirated software, kindly know that many times police come and arrest and raid the school also. It has happened. For example, Regional Institute of Education, Mysore, they got a letter from Microsoft saying, we know that all the faculty are using pirated copies of Microsoft Windows. Kindly pay us 15 lakh rupees or we will send the police to your institution. So that way, Microsoft also doesn't want that its software is being used by people without paying the license fees to it. So if you are doing that in your own institution, you're violating the law. So far, you may not have been caught, but that problem can arise. Somebody may find out that you're using pirated software and they may put a case on you. So better for a college or a school not to be in that difficult or awkward situation. So better to use free and open source software. So Regional Institute of Education, when it got this letter from Microsoft, they told all the faculty, remove pirated software from your computers and use only free and open source software. So now free and open source software is much more common. The second principle, as I said, is you can make copies of it. Third, you can modify the software. Again, you will say, I'm a teacher, why am I going to modify the software? One very important thing about software is all software has a user interface. User interface means when you use a software, it will show some words which we read and we use a software. Unfortunately, many software is available only in English. So GeoGebra, what I showed you in English, correct? But the same GeoGebra is available in Tamil, same GeoGebra is available in Kannada, is available in Hindi, in Marathi, in Bengali, because people like us, teachers, have created the local language versions of the software. So free to modify, teachers can create the local language version of the software so that if you're teaching in a school where Malayalam is the medium of instruction or Oriya is the medium of instruction, the software can also be in that particular language. So it can be in multiple languages. So if you see GeoGebra on my computer, I have around 150 languages I can use GeoGebra in. So that is the advantage that is available because free software, we can only modify. If it's Microsoft Office, we cannot modify. We do not have the right. But if it is free and open source software like GeoGebra, we have the freedom to modify also. So free to study, number one, free to copy, number two, free to modify, number three, and four, very important, free to redistribute. So supposing you made a Tamil version of GeoGebra, you can give it to other people. All these four freedoms are not available with proprietary software, not available with Microsoft Windows, but it is available with free and open source software. Okay. What are these free and open source software? Is it only GeoGebra? Or other applications are also available. We can see So this slide is showing that there are hundreds and thousands of free and open source software. You're using Microsoft Office, stop using Microsoft Office. We use LibreOffice. LibreOffice, same as Microsoft Office, except that it is free and open source. So we can make copies of it. We can put it on multiple computers. In fact, the presentation slide I'm showing you, I'm not using Microsoft PowerPoint. Instead of that, I'm using LibreOffice Impress. So LibreOffice is the free and open source software instead of MS Office. Like that, we are using Chrome browser. Stop using Chrome browser, use Firefox browser. My Mozilla Firefox is free and open. Search engine, you are using Google search engine. Stop using Google search because Google is collecting data about you. It is spying on you. And that spying on you will create harm for you in the future. Instead of that, better use DuckDuckGo search engine. So in IT for Change, we do not use MS Office, we use LibreOffice. Instead of Chrome, we use Firefox. Instead of Google search, we use DuckDuckGo search engine. So these are the applications we have been using for the last 10, 15 years without any problem. We don't have any issues of license fee to be paid for any number of systems that we use, and we are not violating the law, okay? So as far as MS Office is concerned or Chrome is concerned, these are the common software applications all of us are using. But the free and open source world has many more applications also, which you can see in the screen in front of you. So I want to edit a PDF file. I've got a software for that, which is called Acular. I can edit a PDF file. I can add comments to it. I can share comments with other people. I want to split a PDF file into two different files. I want to combine 3-4 PDF files into single file. I have a software for it. I want to create an audio recording for teaching language. So some of the teachers in this particular meeting have been part of a workshop we conducted on a software called Audacity. If you can see the screen, Audacity is for creating audio music, audio records. So for example, if you're teaching language, you're teaching English, you're teaching Hindi, you're teaching Marathi or Malayalam or Telugu or whatever language you're teaching, you can create material. Now for teaching language, print material is what is available in the school. But we all know that print material is not ideal for language teaching, particularly young learners, they have to listen to the language a lot. So to listen to the language, you need to create audio materials. Now what you need software to create audio materials. So that is a software called Audacity. IT for Change has conducted several workshops for mathematics teachers to learn GeoGebra, for English teachers to learn Audacity, etc. So special workshops we have conducted. The software is free and open source, so you can download it from the internet and you can install on your computers. We conduct the training program for teachers to learn how to use it for integrating in the teaching learning processes. Similarly, you want to make videos, there is a software called Kazam, there is a software called VocoScreen. You can make your own videos. It's very easy to make, not at all difficult. And you can make a video for teaching a different concept in science or social science. Geography, for example, you can make videos. You can go outside, you can take a video of different phenomena, geography phenomena connected to geography. You can create a video and you can use a video editing software for making the video itself. So these are some of the applications that are available in the free and open source world, which you can install in your computer. All these software applications are desktop applications, which means you don't need internet for running them. So if you've got 20 systems on your computer, on your computer lab, you can install this in all the 20 systems and each of the subject teacher can start teaching these particular topics, okay? Like that, for subject teaching also, there are software applications which I have mentioned here. GeoGebra is a software for teaching mathematics. I will show you a little later. I can show you the software FET, which is a software for teaching physics. And some of the concepts of physics are very complex, very difficult to understand. You can make science teaching more fun using a software like FET. You can use Stellarium also to teach galactic phenomena, planetarium. It converts your computer to a planetarium. TuxMath is a tool for teaching middle school mathematics. Calcium is a tool for teaching periodic table. Okay, so I'm going to give you 2 minutes to go through this particular slide. If you have any questions or comments, please type in the chat window. For chemistry, there is a software called Calcium. For language, you can use Audacity, you can use Kdenlive. Language teaching essentially is, you know, you create materials for use of students. So you have to create audio materials, you can create video materials. Just today, one of the teachers who was in our course, Audacity course, her name is Sana Ahmed. She's in one of the Montfort institutions in Hyderabad. She shared 3 poems that she has done recording of. And when you do your recording of a poem and you add music to it, you add voice modulation, you do different sound effects and you play it in the classroom, you automatically create an interest in the children to learn language. So It is not very difficult to do. Of course, you have to learn the software and you've got to use it to prepare these resources. But once you prepare these resources, they will be of use in the classroom. For biology, I would think you can use video making tools. So for biology, you want to, you know, explain reproductive phenomena, you want to explain carnivorous plants, you want to look at different phenomena in the living world, you can use a software to, you can make a video of that particular software. For history, again, many of these subjects, for history, there is a software called Timeline. So Prema madam wanted to know about history. I'll request Anand sir to type in the chat window the responses. For history, you want to create a timeline of events. So you want to say what all happened in French Revolution, what all happened in Russian Revolution, what all happened in 1857 revolt. There is a software which is called Timeline software, and that can help you to explain the different events in history as they happen. So Timeline is a software available. For political science, for many other more advanced subjects, what I would suggest is, if you know how to create videos and audio resources, so you are able to create a video, you're able to record the, nowadays everybody has got a phone, right? So we are all having a video camera with us. Every person is having a very sophisticated video camera with us. Now, once the video is shot using the cell phone, you can edit it on your computer using a software called Kden Live or OpenShot. These are the video editing software available. You can add background music, you can put subtitles, you can add some slides, you can do all that to create a interesting video resource for your students' learning. And parts of that video you can actually physically shoot to get the software. Okay, I'm also going to share a web page with you which has got all the software names. It has got the help also of all the software. Okay, so let me just show that to you now. Let me share the web page which has got all the software names as well as are you all able to see your web page, explore an application? Aruna Devi, madam, Dr. Aruna Devi?
Yes.
Yeah, that's also the link that Anand sir has shared in the chat window. So if you open this page, in this particular web page, it's all the software that we learn, all the software that we are using, it is given here under different categories. So for creating text resources, there are so many software applications. For example, there is a very nice software called LibreOffice Math. Now, when you are typing a mathematics question paper, we have a big problem. Square root we have to do, intersection of set theory we have to do, fractions we have to type. So many different symbols are there in mathematics. Sigma symbol is there, Greek alphabets are there. The normal MS Office or the normal text editor may not give us these facilities. There is a separate software called LibreOffice Math. LibreOffice Math for the math teacher is a very big boon, because you can type the maths question paper, set the maths problems using LibreOffice Math. Then subject-wise tools are also here. If you can see on the bottom, GeoGebra is there for mathematics. RoboCompass is also an interesting tool. Some of these software tools are online. So most of them are desktop. You don't need to have connectivity, but RoboCompass is a construction tool. So you want to teach students how to construct a angle bisector. We all know that we teach construction once or twice, but some students need to see the construction multiple times before they understand it. And we cannot be doing the same construction 30 or 40 times, right? So these constructions, RoboCompass is a software for teaching different kinds of constructions, and you can change the value of the variables in the construction. You want to construct a angle bisector for angle measuring 90 degree, you can change the angle measure from 90 to 50 to 60, and the angle bisector construction will change accordingly. So RoboCompass is a tool for constructions. Stellarium is a very beautiful tool. It converts your computer into a planetarium. Now, many of you are not staying in the state capitals. Now, India is a very funny country. We decided that only students who stay in the state capitals can go to planetariums. So Bangalore has a planetarium, Bombay has a planetarium, Hyderabad may be having a planetarium, but Nalgonda won't have a planetarium, Bidar won't have a planetarium, Bareilly won't have a planetarium. So we have decided that planetariums are only for the children who stay in the cities. This is one of the urban-rural problems that people have been talking about. So Stellarium software is a very beautiful software. I have a video that I made of an eclipse in Stellarium, teaching eclipse using Stellarium. If there is time, I will show you that video. It's a 4-minute video that I made. I made the video using a software called Caden Live, using a software called, Record My Desktop to make the video. But that video was made on the Stellarium software. So Stellarium, for every physics teacher who's struggling with explaining galaxies or solar system or comets or different galactic phenomena, Stellarium is a very beautiful software. Now, not only we can use this software for teaching students, more important than that, according to me, we can improve our own knowledge. So as I told you already, I'm not a maths and I'm not a PCM person. But after I started using GeoGebra, after I started using FET, my own understanding of mathematics and science improved. So as teachers, we know we are very good, but our conceptual knowledge can certainly improve. It's not that we are perfect. It's not that we know everything. To improve our own conceptual knowledge, if you play with these software applications, it will make you deeper in your own learning. Okay. So Turtle Blocks is a, you know, Lena Madam was talking about coding, right? So we don't need to have some Haryana engineer, you know, Haryana model where some engineering student has to come and teach us. Even high school teachers can learn this software called Turtle Blocks. It's a visual coding tool. So students who are in high school themselves, they can start creating small code, visual code it is called. We have run Turtle Blocks camp for students. In 3 days time, they become experts. So teachers can learn it in half a day time also. For each of these are links. Can you see that? So if you click on the link, it will open the particular software page. Are you able to see that in the screen, Aruna Madam? Learn Turtle Blocks, is it coming?
Yes, sir.
So this is a user manual for Learn Turtle Blocks. Very simple. We have given screenshots so that it is self-learning material. No need for me to come to your school to conduct a workshop. Now in the COVID time, I can't even do that. I can't come to your school and run a workshop for all of you. But you can go to this webpage. You can see this webpage. It has got the simple instructions on the learning the software. For example, you want to learn GeoGebra. You can click on the GeoGebra link. So here there is a, GeoGebra is here, right? So if you click on GeoGebra, learn GeoGebra, it will give you the whole GeoGebra software, what all you can do, how you can go about learning it. So all these web pages are available online, and IT for Change, we believe in free and open. Free and open means don't prevent learning by putting monetary blocks for teachers and students. We don't believe in that. All the software is free and open. This user manual is also free and open to download and learn and read. Okay.
Yeah. Guru, sir, Sister Pretentia, she is having few queries.
Yes, tell me.
Sister, can you?
Yes, sir. Can you please tell me the disadvantages of using Edge and Bing? Because there are certain issues that they are a little safer when compared to Chrome and Google.
Google, Microsoft, all these are companies that are set up for making profit. I hope you all agree with me. Microsoft is a commercial company. Google is another commercial company. Oracle is a commercial company. Apple is a commercial company. Now, all these commercial companies, they are not established to do good for you and me. They are established to make money for their shareholders. So whether it's Microsoft, which is selling a software called Bing, or Google, which is selling a software for Chrome, they're all equally dangerous. So I cannot tell whether Microsoft is more dangerous or Google is more dangerous. Both are dangerous. So what they will do, they will steal your data from you. So you may think that I'm using Bing. What is the problem? When you're using Bing, that software is proprietary software. Proprietary software means nobody knows what that code is doing. So it is a dark room. In a dark room, can you see anything? You cannot see anything. It's a black box. So Microsoft Bing is collecting data from you. Google Chrome is collecting data from you. They're all collecting data from you. And you can get into trouble in the future. We may say, what is there? My life is open book. Everything about me can be open. I don't have a problem. You all have heard of Disha Ravi, right?
Yeah.
Have you heard of Disha Ravi?
No, sir.
Disha Ravi, you have not heard. She's a girl from Bangalore. Dr. Aruna, have you heard of Disha Ravi?
Yes, sir.
What have you heard of Disha Ravi? Can somebody unmute?
She's an activist, right? Activist. I think many know her.
What happened to her?
She was monitored, right? Excessively.
Yeah, so what happened was she was using Google Doc. Now, I think all of you may be using Google Drive and Google Doc. It's very common, right? So she was using a Google Doc for planning a campaign. Now, that campaign is not a violent campaign. That campaign is not an illegal campaign. It is not a criminal action. She's like a student. She's actually a college student or she's just finished college. I don't know, but a very young person, maybe in her early 20s. She's an environmental activist. So she's supporting the environmental protection. Environment should not be damaged. Grow more trees. That is what she is doing. She was working on a Google document. Now, suddenly one day, police came from Delhi. She is a Bangalore person. They came to her house in Bangalore, arrested her and took her to Delhi and put her in jail. And they said, you are doing some dangerous activity. And we found out because Google gave us your document. So Google, which is, you're using Google Drive, you're using Gmail. I think all of you are using Gmail, correct? Are you paying money for Gmail? Anybody paid money for Gmail?
No.
Why is Gmail free of cost? Why is Google Drive free of cost? Why is Google Photos free of cost? It is free of cost because Google is making money by selling your data. They will sell your Gmail data. They will sell your photos data. They will sell your YouTube videos. They sell it to make money from advertisers. So there is one very famous statement in the technology world, which is, if you are not paying money, you are not the consumer, you are the product. Okay, I want Anand Desai sir to just type this in the chat window. It's a very famous saying in the technology world. If you are not paying money for the product, that means you are not the consumer. You are the product. You are the product that Google sells to advertisers. You are the product that Facebook is selling to advertisers. Facebook and Google are the most profitable companies in the world. How are they making money? They are the most profitable companies. Google is number one. Facebook is number two profitable company in the world. But Facebook is free of cost. WhatsApp is free of cost. Gmail is free of cost. Why is it free of cost? Because you are not the consumer for Google or Facebook. They don't care for you. You are the product. They are selling you to the advertisers and making the money from the advertisers. So tomorrow we may fall in danger. Particularly, I will want to frankly tell all of the people here, many of you are from minority institutions, and we know that situation in the country is not good for minorities. As a person who is a Hindu, I can very clearly say that situation is not good for minorities in this country. Father Stan Swamy, who is 84-year-old Jesuit priest, is in jail for nobody knows what crime he has committed. Last 1 year, he is in jail. He's got COVID and he's not released by the judge and by the police. So that being the situation we are in, we have to be very, very careful when we use digital technologies that we are not using software that is going to collect data about us and then give the data to somebody. We don't know who that somebody can be. Google gave the data of Disha Ravi to the government of India. What is the data of ordinary person of use to them? They use it for advertising, Dr. Alka. So when Dr. Alka is sending a Gmail, in that Gmail she sent to Dr. Aruna, she said that, my anniversary, my son's birthday is there next month. The minute the Gmail, she sent a mail to Dr. Aruna, my son's birthday is next month, she will start getting advertisements for birthday gifts. Not only Dr. Alka will get the advertisement, even Dr. Aruna will get the advertisement because it is sent to her also. How does Google know that you are sharing some information with Dr. Aruna? Now you may think my son's birthday is not some secret. How does it matter? But the problem in today's world is you don't know when what data will be held against you. You may think it is very innocent. You may think there is no problem. When Disha Ravi was writing a toolkit for environmental activism, she was not planning to do anything illegal. It was completely legal activity. But the government simply took that Google Doc information and they tried to put her in jail. Thankfully, there was a lot of protest and the judge gave her bail. She's not free. She's still charge sheeted. She can be arrested anytime, but she has got bail. Unlike Father Stan Swamy, who is still in jail for not committing any crime, he's still in jail. So all these people's computers will be infected by the people who want to arrest you. So when we use proprietary software like a Google Chrome or a Google Drive or a Microsoft products, since the software is not known to us, we are in danger. So I will say, try maximum to use free and open source. I'm not telling always use free and open source because sometimes you may not have an alternative. Supposing you're using Gmail or Dr. Aruna is using Gmail and I'm sending her a mail. Naturally, Google will know my mail also, although I am not using Gmail, I'm using IT for Change Net mail. But since I send the information to Gmail, my mail also becomes public. So sometimes that is a problem. Ideally, we should not be using Gmail, but for many of us, we may not be getting institutional IDs. Ideally, every school, every college should just buy a domain name. Many of you are having websites. So for example, let's say Montfort Institution has got a website called, I'm just saying, Montfort.in. Then every teacher of Montfort Institution can get an email ID at Montfort.in. So in IT for Change, myself and Anand sir, we have got a mail ID, which is guru@itforchange.net, anand.desai@itforchange.net. That way, every institution, if they did that, we do not depend on Google. Google is more dangerous because more Google products all of us are using. So some of the questions, Zoom. So Zoom is also dangerous. Zoom is very, very dangerous. It is a, again, proprietary software platform. We don't know who is doing surveillance here. Now, fortunately, most of the time, teacher's life is open book. So I'm not saying tonight don't sleep. You should only worry about all these things. No, I'm not saying that. We are all open people only. I don't have anything to hide. You don't have anything to hide. So to that extent, we are safe. But in IT for Change, we don't use Zoom. We use a software called Big Blue Button. So I'll request Anand sir to, it is there. Big Blue Button is there on this particular Explore page also, I think. It's a software called Big Blue Button. I'll just, let me just show that. Yeah. Any question?
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, we use a software called Big Blue Button instead of Zoom. And Big Blue Button is very much geared for online teaching. Of course, I completely agree that online teaching is not as good as face-to-face teaching. Even this session, it would have been great if I was in front of you because seeing all your faces will give me energy. Now I'm only seeing Dr. Aruna's face because everybody's put their camera, shut off their camera. So I can't see all of you. And I know it affects it, but Big Blue Button is a free and open source alternative to Zoom. We don't use Zoom in our office. We use only Big Blue Button. Yeah, anything else? Any other questions? Or I can go ahead and do some more demos. We have 15 minutes more, so I can show you another file. I can show a couple of software applications more, and we can learn for it. Yeah, but any questions before that? Yes, go ahead.
Sir, you have talked about using of LibreOffice Impress for PPT, sir.
Yeah.
Is my doubt to you is, if I am using LibreOffice Impress, and can I forward the same PPT to others? Will it open to them, those who don't have this software installed?
Yeah, so this is a very good question. So we have to understand a little bit more about software and file. So we all use software, and using the software, we create a file. Am I right? You use Microsoft PowerPoint, you create a PowerPoint file. You use GeoGebra, you create GeoGebra file. Now, when you create the file, the last three alphabets of the file name after the dot, that is called the file format. So if you create Microsoft PowerPoint file, it will create a .ppt or a .pptx file. Agree? You all know that. If you create a Microsoft Word document, you will create a .doc or a .docx file. In the case of LibreOffice, the file format created is ODT. ODT means open document text. If I'm using PowerPoint in LibreOffice, it will create a ODP, open document presentation. Now, the thing is, these file formats, the whole world, they want the file formats to conform to some open file formats. So fortunately, in today's world, most of the file formats that are used by the proprietary, by the free and open applications, they can be opened and edited by the proprietary applications also. So if I'm using LibreOffice Impress, if you send me a PPT file, I can open it, no problem. If I save it as an ODP file and send it to another person who does not have LibreOffice, they can also open it in PowerPoint. Okay. It is like you are having a Maruti 800 car. I am having a Santro car. When we go, are we having separate petrol bunk for Hyundai car and Maruti car? Maruti car petrol separate, Hyundai car petrol separate. Is it like that?
No, sir.
Are we having different roads for Maruti car separate road, for Hyundai car separate road? No. So some of these platforms are standard across application. So the .doc file as well as a .odt file are both openable and editable in MS Office also, LibreOffice also. Okay. So the file format is very important. As much as possible, use open file formats. So .docx is not open, .ppt is not open. That's another reason not to use Microsoft Office. But if you're using LibreOffice software, you're creating a .odp or a .odt file, you send it to a person who has got Microsoft Office, they can also open it. But in case they are not able to open it, listen very carefully, in case they are not able to open it, in your LibreOffice, you can save as .doc. That is allowed by LibreOffice. You can save .doc also, .ppt also, .xls also, and send the file to them. Okay. So that is the advantage of using LibreOffice. Another advantage is LibreOffice works on Windows also. So you can use that. Now, main software that we are having on our computer is Windows, correct? Microsoft Windows is operating system. So in the case of free and open source, we don't use Microsoft Windows. We use Linux. So the software that we are using in the case of our operating system is called Linux. Okay. So how many of you might have heard of this word Linux? Linux is the operating system. And we are using a Linux operating system. We have a DVD or we have a website where we have put this software. You can download and install. Along with Ubuntu, it will be including GeoGebra, include LibreOffice, include Kdenlive. All the software that I showed you, everything is included in that one website only. So I'm going to show that to all of you so that you can learn how to install it in your computers. Yeah. Can you see this slide? So these are all the software applications. We have a single software called Kalpavriksha. This is nothing but Ubuntu operating system. The web link is given there. Can you all see that last line? Sorry, that last line is only the user manual. So Anand sir, will you just type the website, Coer website? There is a web page called Installing Ubuntu. Or I can also do it. I can just type it in the chat window. Are you all able to see the slide which is having the information about the software installation? Because all of you will want to know how can I get this software. So I'm just going to type the link for installing Ubuntu. Yeah, what you're still seeing the, what are you seeing? You're seeing the web page? I'll just share the web page now. I'll share the link also in the chat window. Yeah, can everybody see the link on the chat window? This is the page, install Ubuntu. In this web page, we are given the instructions for installing Ubuntu as well as downloading Ubuntu. You can install Ubuntu from this. So if you see here, can you see this link? Click here to download Ubuntu. Is it all visible to everybody? Aruna, Dr. Aruna, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
So if you click on this link, you can install, you can download the Ubuntu to your own computer. You can put it on a pen drive and you can install the Ubuntu software. Ubuntu is the operating system. So operating system means automatically inside the operating system, we have put all the other software also. So you don't, one advantage of Ubuntu is in the case of Microsoft, you have to install Microsoft Windows separate, Microsoft Office separate, Adobe separate, everything has to be installed separately, correct? In the case of Ubuntu, you install only Ubuntu, everything is installed at the same time. GeoGebra will be installed, Kdenlive, all the software applications that I showed you get installed at the same time. All these applications which are there on this page, everything gets installed at the same time. Yeah, the software link is already shared in the chat window above. Sister Francis, above, can you see that software link?
Sir, is it shared with everyone, sir?
Yeah, it is shared with everyone. Again, now I've shared it, you can see.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah,
so this link is available online. So here on the same site only, you can download the software. You can install the software. You need a technical person. Obviously, you are not going to install it yourself. There are some technical steps involved, which is available, explained in this particular web page. So let me show the web page where it's explained. Yeah, so in this particular page, the installation process is fully, this web page is only about installing the software of Ubuntu, okay? So I just have 10 more minutes. I'm going to end with a science lesson. I hope people don't mind.
Sir, one question was there.
Yes, please ask.
Yeah, I am Father Thomas P.T. talking from Bihar, Buxar.
Yes, sir.
When you were talking about this installing Firefox as a browser, I just downloaded the Firefox in my mobile.
Hmm.
So there also the default search engine is Google.
Yeah, you can change it to DuckDuckGo.
Change into?
DuckDuckGo. So the search engine that I use is called, I'm just typing in the chat window, called DuckDuckGo. Yeah. DuckDuckGo does not take your data.
Okay.
Google search engine survives by taking your data only. They become rich by taking your data. Okay, they steal your data from you.
Yeah, yeah.
But instead of Google search, you can use DuckDuckGo. I use DuckDuckGo 80% of the time. 10% I'm not happy with DuckDuckGo search. Then I go to Google. So on my Firefox browser, you can have DuckDuckGo also. You can have Google also. Okay. Okay, not that you, I don't use Google search. I use Google search, but I use it 10% of the time. 90% I'm happy with DuckDuckGo. You're all understanding what I'm saying? Both options are available. As much as possible, I try to avoid proprietary. But sometimes I cannot help it. Like, for example, if I have to send an email to somebody who's using Gmail, I don't have a choice. That data is going to be used by Google illegally or without telling me what they're going to do with it. But I don't have a choice in that matter. Okay.
When the
questions? Yes.
Sir?
Yes.
When DuckDuckGo was typed, another option is coming, search a string to use.
See, I will not know specifically on your phone what options you have got. But maybe you can, you know, ask somebody in your family who is slightly more comfortable with the mobile app installations. You can install Firefox and DuckDuckGo on your phone and make sure that you use both of them. So once you know the names, then that's, you have to follow some steps to make sure that you're using the software on your phone also. I think you are making a very important point. Today, people use phone much more than computers. Yeah. So along with using free and open source software on the computer, let us try to use free and open source software on the phone also. So on my phone also, I use Firefox. On my phone, I don't use Chrome. See, you are buying a cell phone, 99% will have Android. Android is made by Google. Naturally, they'll put all the Google products on your phone. Whether you like it or not, whether you want it or not, Google Drive will be there, Google Gmail will be there, Google account will be there. But you can avoid using that on the phone also. So alternative to Gmail, there are other alternatives, but ideally, you know, if you have an institution which has a website, you can ask the website provider to provide you email IDs based on your institution itself, rather than, you know, it being a Gmail ID. So that's a question from Dr. Alex, what is alternative to Gmail? I'm going to suggest that institution should use mail server with their, like Aloysius Christu Jayanti has its own mail server. So they don't need to use Gmail. So in the same way for others also. What is the alternative browsers and search engines? Unsafe software commonly used, but should be avoided. I would say that proprietary software is dangerous. But other than that, I'm not aware of any specific unsafe software that we are all using. But generally, as a general rule, proprietary software, we don't know what the source code is, what it is, secrets it has got, what it is going to steal from us. So from that point of view, better to avoid. Even on the WhatsApp, we use WhatsApp on the phone. We know that Facebook owns WhatsApp. WhatsApp is very popular, but instead of using WhatsApp, you can use Telegram. So on the mobile phone, free and open source compared to WhatsApp, Telegram is free and open. And you can use Telegram or Signal instead of WhatsApp. Simi Madam is saying we are not tech savvy. That's true. Now, how do you become tech savvy? By using technology and learning about it. So there is no magic way to become tech savvy. I'm not a good biology teacher. How do I become a good biology teacher? I have to learn biology. There is no other alternative. So in the same way, to become tech savvy, you become more, use more and more technology, particularly this free and open source application that we have shown. As a social and teachers, they are very good. You can start creating videos for different topics in geography and history. And you will find that that makes you and the students also more interested in the social science subjects also. And that's one way we can become more tech savvy. It will take time. I have no illusions that it is going to happen in 1 week or 1 month's time. It is a multi-year journey. But if we can start doing it, we can do. Exhausted after school work, I know. Life of a teacher is tough, so I don't have easy solutions for that. But some of these things are interesting. So I find that at 11 in the night, although I'm very tired, I open my Twitter and start reading Twitter messages. I'm very tired, but still Twitter is attracting me. So that way, if you start using some of these software applications which are interesting, you'll find that they're interest to you. Yeah, WhatsApp has end-to-end encryption, but WhatsApp can steal your data. So that is the problem with WhatsApp and Facebook. Now, Facebook, which owns WhatsApp, is saying, I will take WhatsApp data and use it along with Facebook. We all know that. That's the latest problem in India and all over the world. Facebook can do whatever it wants. Tomorrow it can change the rules because you are not paying money to WhatsApp. You're not paying money to Facebook. So the contract, there is no contract between you and them. The contract is they can do whatever they want. You have to listen to them. That is the contract between you and them. Because if you know in any software, at the end of the thing, it will say, I agree. For installing the software, they'll have 20 kilometers of conditions, which you don't read, which I also don't read, correct? It's called EULA. If you heard of that, end user license agreement, it's called EULA. So EULA will have hundreds of conditions. We will take this from you, we will take that from you. What we will do, we'll go in the end and say, I agree. And we click on that. We don't even read what it is saying. So we don't have any rights as far as proprietary software is concerned. That is a danger. At least let us become aware. Let us reduce the use of it. Okay. Now, last lesson before I close. What is it that you're able to see? I hope you're all able to see the web page. Let me share the web page again. What are you all able to see now? Dr. Aruna, what can you see?
I can see a pendulum kind of animation.
This is a question to all of you. What are the factors? So now the pendulum is moving, right? I have stopped it. I'm again moving it, right? Is the motion, has the speed changed?
Yeah.
Yes, so the speed has changed. So when we teach science, again, you know, the fun about technology is not that it is some jazzy thing, but like in GeoGebra, you can use technology to help the students to understand the concept better. So again and again, I will repeat that the use of technology is not simply to automate what you are doing in the manual way, but it is to use technology to help the conceptual understanding become better. So in the case of science, one of the problems that we have, like I said, mathematics, algorithmic teaching is a problem. Students hate mathematics, students dislike mathematics, and that is a fault of the teaching that method that we follow. We write the whole sum on the blackboard, we explain it to the student, student writes down the answer, and they don't understand what they are doing. Similarly, science also, we just tell students about science. We will tell the laws of motion. We will tell, when we tell and teach, it is not of great use to the students. Again, I'm not generalizing. Some teachers may do like that. Some teachers may be doing it differently. So I'm not generalizing. But using this software called FET, I can ask the question, what are the parameters that determine the speed of the pendulum? Can people type in the chat window? What are the parameters? In what way can I change the speed of the pendulum? That is my question. You're all seeing a pendulum move in front of you. Length of the string, Dr. Alka is correct. So one is called the length of the string. So let me change the length of the string. Let's see what happens when I change the length of the string. So you all can see that I can change the length of the string. It's become long, right? Now, when I move the thing, what does it happen? When the length increased, what has happened to the speed? Can anybody say what happens when the length increased? Or, yeah, let me know what has happened. Can you see? The length reduced, so the speed increased. Am I right? So we can ask the students this question. What are the factors that influence the speed of the pendulum? So one is length. Another is friction. So Dr. Alex is saying friction. You all can see in front of you. I'm increasing the friction on the screen. What has happened to the speed? The speed has reduced. I reduce the friction, the speed will increase, right? So we can ask students, think of more and more variables by which the speed of the pendulum can change, okay? So this is a website called FET. You can also download this FET experiment to your computer. So it doesn't have to be online when you want to show to the students. In fact, I'm showing it from my computer only. So length is one, mass is, gravity is one, as well as friction. These are the three parameters that influence the speed of the pendulum. Okay. I think I'll stop here because it's 7:15. You all must be extremely tired. And I don't want you to start muttering, you know, under your breath as to how long will this guy go on for. So I'll stop now. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your time. If there are any questions, please type in the chat window. Otherwise, my session is over. I didn't complete sharing all the slides with you, but I will email the slides to Dr. Aloysius so that he can send it to all the participants. Okay. Thank you, everybody. If there are questions, you can type in the chat window. Otherwise, we can close the session.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm unmuting. Let it count. But the count is
more, yes, ma'am. More compliments only, ma'am. More compliments only. Thank you so much, Gurumurthy sir. Yes, ma'am. Maybe we will take one question and then we will go ahead with whatever things. Yeah, any one question. Father Thomas, please unmute and ask.
Vibhalina Datta. Father.
You had already asked my question, sir.
Okay. Fine, sir.
Ma'am, this is Vibhalina Datta here. Sir already read my question from the chat box and answer.
Fine. Okay. Right.
Are people able to see my email ID in the share?
Sir, it is gray color. So it,
okay.
Let it me is visible, change. But I don't know how far.
Okay. Let me.
Yeah, Dr. Aruna, you can go ahead.
Yes, sir. I've posted sir's email ID also in the chat window. Okay, so sir, your energy and aura is felt by everyone during the session. It gave a thought that online teaching can be as very effective. You showed it how it could be done. The showering of the essential information which everyone had in mind. Thank you for the wonderful interactive session, sir. We have come to the end of day two of our annual educators meet. I'll conclude with a formal vote of thanks. Education is the best tool which transforms the lives of achieving economic and social mobility, inclusion, and equality. The practical implementation of NEP 2020 is no longer difficult with the able enthusiasm of ever-learning teachers' approach. I submit my sincere and heartfelt gratitude to Sri Gurumurthy Kasinathan, a renowned educator who motivated and inspired all of us with his powerful and friendly talk. On behalf of everyone gathered here, I thank you, dear sir. I submit my sincere thanks to all the delegates and teachers for the active involvement during the presentation. I also thank the organizing committee members and tech team for their support in managing the virtual meeting. Thank you, one and all. A small announcement regarding day three of the virtual meet. The day three of virtual meet commences with panel discussion by 3 p.m. tomorrow. I kindly request you to join on time. For all the updates, kindly follow our WhatsApp group or check your registered email IDs. Wishing you a fruitful day ahead.